So imagine that you are in the foyer of a concert hall, and perhaps you've been dragged there by a parent. Maybe you're just a kid, or perhaps you're the parent who's done the dragging, or perhaps you're just there with a peer, a friend, and you're both super excited to be there. What's happened is the ushers are telling you to come into the auditorium, so you're going into the auditorium, you take your place, and at some point you begin to read your program notes, and it tells you what you have to expect. There's going to be compositions from Bach, straight through to the modernist composer Webern. And so that's all very interesting and exciting. At some point, your attention is drawn to the stage, and there you see that the concertmaster has invited the oboe to play a note. And the oboe's note has been followed by the woodwinds, and then the brass, and the rest of the brass instruments. And before you know it, slowly but surely, all the instruments are playing the same note. It's 440 hertz. It's what we call A in the music Western tonal system. And what happens, the conductor comes in to a round of applause, and then there's a general hush as you wait for the music to start. So I started with this scenario because I thought it highlighted quite early on already just how many things can influence how we perceive music. Take, for instance, the fact that you are in an auditorium, so it's a live performance. You aren't just listening to the music, you're also watching it being performed. And we know that, you know, actually this can have a huge influence on how we actually hear the music, or, you know, perceive the music. Another thing to consider is that you've been reading about the music you're about to hear, you know, who was composed by. Perhaps you've also been told what to listen out for while you're listening. So again, you have this top-down information, which we know from research can really influence how you receive the bottom-up information, which is what's actually coming into your ears. But I'd like to start by sort of focusing on something that's even more fundamental than, you know, what's coming in, you know, through your eyes and, you know, what you've read about the music you're about to hear, and talk about actually why the performers actually chose to go through the whole process of tuning their instruments. And you might say, well, it's just so that they play in tune, but it just reminds us actually that there's a huge organizing principle in music, which is that we use very specific frequencies out of all the possible frequencies we can use. And that brings us to the notion of a tuning system. So a tuning system is basically a system that, you know, defines how we should select specific frequencies out of all the possible frequencies we could use. And in different cultures, we have different tuning systems. Most of them revolve around this notion of octave equivalence. And that's just generally the notion that two pitches are an octave apart if they have a frequency ratio of 2:1, and also if they sound similar, the same. And actually what happens across cultures is people take an octave and then they split it in different ways. In the Western tonal system, we split it into 12, and you have, you know, 12 notes making the chromatic scale. In other cultures, like gamelan music in Bali, it's actually split into 5 or 7. And what happens is when you listen as a person who's enculturated to one or the other system, it's quite your system. What you're used to hearing seems, you know, perfectly logical. And when you listen to another music in another tuning system, it might sound a little bit foreign or exotic. And that's already going to influence very much how we perceive music, what tuning system has been used to actually compose it. Another important principle is that of tonality. So I sort of threw in the fact that you might be hearing compositions from Bach through to Webern. The emphasis here, or what I was trying to allude to, is the fact that you're going to be listening to compositions from the 1700s and ones in the 1900s. And basically what happened in the 1900s is that these composers often decided to not stick to tonality. So what is tonality? I talked about tuning systems. Tonality is basically the fact that within all the pitches that we decide we can play music with, you can still compose music such that, you often compose music such that it only takes a selection of those pitches once more. So there's a hierarchy of pitches that are used to compose the music, and the idea is that compositions revolve around a tonic, a sort of central tone, and lots of musical cultures exhibit tonality in that they revolve around a central tone. But again, how, you know, these tonalities look across different cultures can be very different. And like I said, even within a culture, some composers choose to use it, others don't. What it means is that your perception of a composition that was, you know, tonal is very different to one that isn't tonal, because in one case you can make predictions as to how music is going to unfold because you already have this hierarchy. In another case, you can't. So having introduced this idea of tonality and tuning systems, I'd like to now, much later, actually volunteer or sort of give a definition of music perception. And music perception has been defined as just the process whereby we sort of organize, identify, sort of try to interpret musical information so that we have a representation of it, and that so that we actually reach some sort of understanding of it. And it happens on a range of different time scales. So we're listening to music now, but we're also sort of still listening to the same music, you know, tens of minutes later sometimes, in the case of, you know, multi-movement composition. And so what's interesting for researchers is to try to understand music perception at all these different timescales. So for instance, you might care about what's happening on this, you know, scale of like hundreds of milliseconds. What can we actually do with that information? Well, we can decide whether what we're hearing is a violin or a flute. And that's because we psychological research has shown that there are different, you know, we have these dimensions that we use to try to distinguish between these instruments. One of them is the attack time, so how quickly the note reaches its full intent. An instrument, when you play a note with an instrument, how quickly it reaches the full intensity of the sound. And so in the case of, let's take a piano for instance, it has a very short attack time. You hear it, it gets loud very quickly, and then it sort of recedes again. Compare that with a flute, where it takes a while to build up to its full intensity. Those two things, the length of the attack time actually allows us to distinguish them. Something else that allows us to distinguish them is basically how much energy there are in the higher frequencies of the sound. It's worth mentioning that any natural sound actually has a fundamental frequency, the lowest, and also a range of other frequencies, what are called partials, above it. And depending on how much energy, how intense the those sounds are in the higher frequencies, an instrument can sound brighter or less bright. And again, we can use that to determine whether we're listening to this one instrument or the other. So that's kind of happening very quickly, actually. But of course, we're also, when we're perceiving music, we're also picking out things like melodies, and that may take place over a few seconds. You decide that this is a melody. And how do we represent that? We don't just memorize pitches and say, oh, that's frequency 440, 466. Rather, we extract often just relative pitches and the contour. And so what we care more about is whether the melody goes, you know, notes go up and then down and then up again and then down for a long time, etc. So but the idea is, once we have that representation, we can use it as a template or something important with which to sort of keep processing the music that we're hearing. And so we have attention and memory processes coming in when we start to try to make sense or perceive music's long-term structure, large-scale structure. In terms of the methods that we can use to try to understand music perception, basically there's a whole range. You could say, well, I'm just going to do behavioral studies and ask people to tell me what they hear. You could decide to do neuroimaging studies, of course, and try to see what's happening in the brain when you're manipulating certain features of the music. But there's a whole bunch of others you can, you know, approaches you can take. You could say, well, I want to carry out cross-cultural studies because I care about how being enculturated in a tonal system, for instance, influences how you then perceive this given sound. So if we take two people, different backgrounds, they've been enculturated to different musical schemes, how do they process this differently? And that can be very enlightening. You could also look at study infants or children. And why might you do that? Well, you want to see how musical perceptual abilities develops over the lifespan. And that's how we know, for instance, that a sort of sense of tonality, those rules guiding tonality, start developing in children about 4 to 7. They start before that, they're actually quite open and they are actually better at adults and lots of things. But then you could also use study, you know, across species. That's how we know that rats and actually monkeys have the same ability. And so I guess you could say that research into music perception can really be approached from a whole bunch of different perspectives. And part of the interest is actually having bringing together all of these perspectives to try to understand how it works in general. Here's some work I was doing a few years ago. It was looking at individuals with a disorder known as congenital amusia. Now, these individuals will show difficulty recognizing that that song I'm singing or maybe humming is Happy Birthday. Now, most of us know the tune Happy Birthday. We've been hearing it since we were one, perhaps. But these individuals will have difficulty with that. And so we carried out a series of studies to try to understand why that might be, why they have these difficulties. And just to give an idea of what we found, well, the first question was, do we have difficulty learning, do they have difficulty rather learning the structure of the tonal system that they should be exposed, that they've been exposed to? What we found out was that it wasn't that simple. They seemed to be able to learn the structure of tonal sequences just as well as controls. We then asked, well, are they able to, even if they aren't able to explicitly say that they've heard, a wrong note in a melody, for instance, is it possible that they're implicitly processing it? And interestingly, what we found was that that was the case. So they were actually able to recognize implicitly that, this note is more unexpected in that context than the other one, in that context being the melody. And then we did some EEG to show, in fact, the brain is tracking information that they can't consciously report. And so we found out that there was this sort of, there might be, the disorder might be one of, conscious awareness of the information that they actually do have. But, that sort of question then opens up a whole new bunch of questions, which in the end, I guess, you have to decide what you study at any one time. But in terms of, in terms of the broader question of, are there any, outstanding questions? I guess it depends on where you decide to focus. So I already said how many different approaches you can use to study music perception. Those people who are working on, looking across species will have, tons of questions within that. I'm currently working a lot on emotion and music-induced emotions, and basically there with every experiment that I carry out, there's, five different follow-up experiments that I need to carry out to satisfy my curiosity.